Imagine this scenario. It's the year 2011, a year in which the dancehall music scene was being dominated by a singularly unique and transformative artist, none other than Vybz Kartel. For those not in the know, Vybz Kartel is a globally revered figure in the dancehall music scene, having achieved a degree of fame and success that was virtually unprecedented in the genre. Vybz Kartel, whose birth name is Adija Palmer, was born and raised in the heart of Kingston, Jamaica, and had been a fixture of the city's music scene from a very young age. He was a man who had risen from humble beginnings to become one of the most celebrated artists of his time. A man whose music was as infectious as his personality was captivating. In the midst of this whirlwind of success, Vybz Kartel found himself in a predicament that was as unexpected as it was shocking. Here he was, in his luxurious hotel room in New Kingston, surrounded by the hard-nosed officers of Kingston's Flying Squad, a unit known for their relentless pursuit of justice, irrespective of a suspect's status or reputation. The situation was intense, surreal even. There he was, Vybz Kartel, a man at the pinnacle of his career, staring down the barrel of a life-changing accusation. The authorities had come knocking, not for a serious crime such as murder assault, but for a minor marijuana-related offense. Yes, a minor offense. An offense that, in most circumstances, would have been dealt with swiftly and without much fuss. Yet here he was, having his personal phone seized, being detained and subjected to an interrogation that lasted for an agonizing 72 hours. As the hours turned into days, the gravity of the situation began to set in. Vybz Kartel found himself confined to a jail cell, a far cry from the glitz and glamour of the stage and the adoration of his fans. Outside, his music continued to play, his popularity continued to rise, but inside, he was trapped in a reality that bore an uncanny resemblance to a nightmare. And all this because of what? A minor marijuana charge? A single joint? Yes, that's how it all began. But as the days wore on, it became evident that the police weren't just interested in a minor drug charge. They had a larger plan in motion, a more sinister agenda. They were determined to apprehend Vybz Kartel, come what may. In a shocking twist, what began as a minor marijuana-related arrest quickly spiraled into something far more serious. Murder charges were abruptly added to the list of accusations against him. The first charge accused him of killing a man by the name of Barrington Bossy Burton, a well-known club promoter. Despite the severity of the accusation, the police had little concrete evidence to back up their claim. But Vybz Kartel, ever the fighter, managed to successfully contest the charge in court, demonstrating his innocence and proving that he was no murderer. However, the authorities were far from done. They retained him, and soon after, another murder charge was added. This time, it was for the murder of Clive Lizard Williams. As if that wasn't enough, multiple other murder charges were added, each one more damning than the last. Amidst all these accusations, one piece of evidence began to take center stage. His personal phone, seized at the time of his arrest, suddenly became a crucial piece of evidence. This phone, which had been confiscated under the pretense of a minor drug charge, took an unexpected and pivotal role in his conviction. Murder charges were added, and a crucial piece of evidence, his phone, would play a surprising role in his conviction.
Now let's delve into the evidence that led to Vybz Kartel's conviction. The core of the evidence was based on a string of text messages and phone calls that seemed to implicate Kartel in the murder of Clive Lizard Williams. This evidence is an intriguing element of the case, raising several queries. Imagine this situation. Kingston's Flying Squad circles a hotel room. Inside, Vybz Kartel apprehended for a minor marijuana-related offense. His phone seized by the authorities. Following this, he's detained for 3 days. Suddenly, murder charges are appended to his case with no clear rationale. This sequence is puzzling, to say the least. The plot thickens when we consider that the authorities had possession of Kartel's phone from the onset. Yet, they chose not to utilize any of the supposedly incriminating evidence on it until after the murder charges were imposed. One can't help but question, if the authorities had such evidence, why didn't they use it straight away? Instead, they first attempt to charge him for a murder with scant evidence and turn to his phone later, seemingly manipulating it to bolster their case. This unusual timeline casts a shadow of doubt, hinting at possible foul play. One cannot help but wonder, why would the authorities go to such lengths to incriminate a renowned dancehall artist? What was there to gain? These lingering questions add to the case's mystery and intrigue. As we delve deeper into this tangled case, more inconsistencies and peculiarities emerge. The fact that the purportedly incriminating evidence from Cartel's phone was only utilized post the murder charges raises serious doubts about the evidence's authenticity and reliability. Was the evidence tampered with to fit the authorities' narrative? The tale of Vibbs Cartel's legal ordeal is multi-layered, filled with unexpected turns. At the heart of it lies a burning question. Was this influential artist falsely accused for a crime he didn't commit? The evidence, or lack thereof, combined with an odd sequence of events, seems to suggest so. One can't help but question, was Vibbs Cartel framed?
Enter David John Martin Woodgate, a British-certified digital forensic expert. A respected figure in the world of digital forensics, Martin Woodgate stepped into the spotlight with a reputation for precision and comprehensive investigation. With his entry, the case was on the verge of a major revelation. His approach was methodical, leaving no stone unturned as he dissected the evidence put forth by the prosecution. The key piece of evidence was a video that allegedly placed Vibbs Cartel at the scene of the crime. Martin Woodgate meticulously examined this piece, his seasoned eye quickly picking up on inconsistencies. The timestamp and metadata didn't match. This discrepancy wasn't minor. It cast doubt on the authenticity of the video itself. But that wasn't the extent of his findings. Shattering all expectations, Martin Woodgate presented another shocking piece of evidence. The phone, crucial to the case and supposedly in police custody, had been used. Unbelievably, it was not a dormant piece of evidence as it should have been, but active and in use after it had been seized. This was a flagrant breach of protocol, a fact that couldn't be ignored or dismissed. Serious questions arose regarding the handling of the evidence. How and why was the phone used after being seized by the authorities? Why were standard law enforcement protocols not adhered to? Why were there inconsistencies in the video's metadata? These were not insignificant errors. They pointed towards potential tampering with the evidence. Martin Woodgate's findings could fundamentally change the trajectory of Vibbs Cartel's case. It might be the key to unveiling the truth to ensuring justice. Whether these revelations will impact the final verdict, only time will tell. However, one thing's for certain. The case of Vibbs Cartel is far from over.
Vibbs Cartel's attorney, Isat Buchanan, is not backing down. Amid adversity, he remains unyielding, spotlighting the questionable handling of key evidence. The core of his argument centers on possible tampering with timestamps and the mishandling of the phone, a central piece of evidence. Isat draws attention to facts that are indeed troubling. The mobile, meant for secure evidence storage, was used to make calls post-seizure. This significant violation of law enforcement rules is shocking. It presents serious inquiries about the authenticity of the evidence and the impartiality of the trial. However, the battle is far from finished. In a potentially pivotal maneuver, the Privy Council, the United Kingdom's Supreme Court, has consented to evaluate Cartel's appeal. This development is a crucial stride towards Vibbs Cartel's liberation. It implies that Isat Buchanan's objections are being heard and acknowledged. The dubious evidence and the events surrounding it have generated sufficient uncertainty to necessitate a re-evaluation of the case by this respected legal entity. Isat Buchanan's resolve is steadfast. He is preparing to argue for Cartel's freedom before the Privy Council in London in the early part of 2024. His slogan, "The defense never rests," reverberates through the corridors of justice. This sentiment aligns with the hopes of Vibbs Cartel's devoted fans. They persistently hope that their favorite artist will soon walk free, his reputation untangled from a possibly flawed legal proceeding. Despite the challenges, the quest for Vibbs Cartel's freedom persists. As the fight continues, the world watches, waiting to see whether justice will ultimately be served. Only time will reveal whether justice will prevail.